Well, hey there, this is Pastor Scott Gould, and I'm so thankful that you've decided to join us here to worship the living God. And our online worship services are available to you to help and to encourage you, to lead you in worshiping God Almighty in the name of His Son, Jesus Christ. And we're thankful that you have decided to be a part of this worship time. And we just want to encourage you that this online resource, this online worship service, should in no way replace or inhibit you or anyone else from being a part of Christian fellowship with other believers. And so we would want to encourage each of us to be a part of a Christian Bible study, a Christian small group, and then continue to gather together with other believers face to face. So if we can be of help to you in any way, please call the church office. Please let us know, let me know how you would desire to be a part of Christian fellowship with other believers face to face. And so may God bless you, and would you just be willing right now to open your heart to the living God, and let's worship together.
God is good. Amen? Amen? Amen. It is so wonderful to hear the creative and the talented music of God's people. And all of that is to give God praise and glory. And so once again, God is good. Amen? Amen. Well, good morning and welcome to all of you. It is so good. We were praying this morning and thanking God that He set an example for us and showed us how He made the Sabbath for us, that we would rest in Him, rest in His goodness, rest in His love, and in His grace. And so good to be together this morning. I want to invite you to take out your bulletin and look at the back cover with me. We just have a few announcements this morning that we want to acknowledge. And first of all, I just want to say congratulations to Orion and Brandy. Many of you know Brandy Jones, and they were married yesterday, and so we just want to say congratulations to the two of them, and praise God. Marriage is God's idea, and every time someone engages in marriage and is willing to pledge before God, I'm going to be committed to this one for life, we can rejoice and praise God. And right in that same vein, we want to thank God together and acknowledge the passing of Debbie Mills' son, Tripper, and the flowers on the altar are given in memory of Tripper. And tonight, actually at 7 p.m., there will be a memorial service right here at 7 p.m., and you're invited to come and share in the comfort of God's love. And you'll see right under that that today is kind of the last hurrah of the normal school Sunday morning worship schedule. And so beginning next Sunday, we'll be here at 9 a.m. And so get ready for that. Set your maybe calendar alert so that you, if you show up at 10, we would still welcome you next Sunday. We'll probably greet you, on our way out the door. That'll be fine. That'll be fine. We'll still fellowship with you in the name of Jesus. With all that in mind, I want to invite up Lisa Powell, our Sunday school superintendent. She has some Sunday school awards. So thank you. Could we just thank God for Lisa? Could we thank God together? Thank you for serving. Thank you for leading.
Good morning. Well, as Pastor said, today was our last day of Sunday school. So I have some attendance awards to give out. We had one student that was here every single time we had Sunday school. And the rest, you had to have 80% or above to get an attendance award today. So our student with perfect attendance this Sunday school year was Colton Billings. All right, and the rest, just come up when you hear your name, please. Charlotte Powell. Will Schluter. Lily Jepson, Sarah Rademacher, Aaliyah Gould, Johnny Frost, Luke Rademacher, Mira Kennel, Alexander Scott, and Sydney Scott.
And so once again, could we thank God for our Sunday school teachers, and let's just celebrate a year of Sunday school. We're mindful here at St. Paul's of the importance of Christian education that happens in our homes, obviously out of great importance, but it also happens really wherever we go as followers of Jesus. We get to be learning together in the church, in our homes, and then wherever we go, we get to share the knowledge of Jesus. And so really thankful for our Sunday school program. And at this time, I want to invite you to stand with me as we go before the Lord in prayer. Father, as we agree in your presence, we give you thanks for your word, and that God, you have always been faithful to your word. And Lord God, I pray that you'd continue to build within us, in our hearts, in our minds, in our habits,
in our plans, in our priorities, in what we value. Oh God, that we would put the reading, the studying, the memorizing, the teaching of your word, and may it continue to be in our lives and in our homes of utmost importance. And God, we recognize that all around the globe, your word is being translated and shared with people. And may we continue here at St. Paul's to cherish your word. And Lord God, make us ready. And Lord God, help us to be faithful in the endeavor of holding on to your word, allowing your word to be at the center of everything that we're doing as Christians. And may your word be received by us in our hearts, and may it, according to your word, not return to you void. Accomplish all that you desire in our lives. And we thank you, God, and we praise you. God, we pray today, even in your midst, oh God, as we're together, would you continue to raise up workers in this congregation, workers that would be faithful in your word, in season and out of season. Oh God, raise up workers. We thank you for our Sunday school program, for all of our teachers. Thank you for all of the small groups that are meeting in season and out of season. God, thank you for the family devotional times, learning your word together. Oh God, continue to stir our hearts, even as we get ready for a summer season. Thank you that many of the farmers here and around us have completed or nearly completed a planting season. Lord God, we thank you for the preaching of your word. May it be planted in our hearts afresh and anew today. And so we thank you, God. Thank you for your presence here. We've come here, we've gathered together to worship you, to exalt, to lift up the name of Jesus Christ, the name that is above every other name. And we agree together in your presence, and we pray in Jesus' name. And everyone agreed and said, amen. Would you remain standing with me as we would confess our sin? It's printed in your bulletin. And as we confess these words together, let's allow these words to work in our hearts. O Lord, have mercy on us. We all stumble in many ways. We cannot tame our tongues. From our mouths we curse people who are made in the likeness of God and boast of great things. We are imperfect and sinful, but you promise your grace to us through faith in Jesus Christ. We cling to him only for our salvation. May he strengthen us to speak and act in wisdom and blessing. Amen. Amen. And I want to invite you to remain standing and let's sing our hymns that are printed in your bulletin. Let's continue to worship together.
Thank you.
first scripture reading is from Romans chapter 3, verses 10 to 20. Romans 3, beginning with verse 10. As it is written, there is none righteous, not even one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become useless. There is none who does good. There is not even one. Their throat is an open grave. With their tongues they keep deceiving. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their paths, and the path of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God. Because by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. For through the law comes the knowledge of sin. The second scripture reading is found in Matthew chapter 12, verses 33 to 37. Matthew 12, starting with verse 33. Make a tree good, and its fruit will be good, or make a tree bad, and its fruit will be bad, for a tree is recognized by its fruit. You brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say anything good? For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. But I tell you that everyone will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every empty word they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. May God bless the reading of his word.
Well, good morning. How are you guys? Good. Well, I brought someone up here with me. Do you guys know who this is? Yeah, it's my daughter. What's her name? Rebecca. And Rebecca is finishing up her sophomore year at Rantoul High School. She's a volleyball player. She runs track. She's in the band. She's on the student council. Okay, and this part's just a secret between you and me, okay? She also has a crush on the saxophone player in the band. I'm sorry. It's no big deal. It's just among friends. No one's gonna find out. People are texting. Okay, more texting. All right, it's blowing up. I'm sorry, Becca. I'm sorry. Why do you guys think she walked out? Because I told everyone her secret. That's right. You know, the Bible says that our words can be like a fire. So if I start a fire, a forest fire, does it stay small? No, it spreads. And can I fix it once it burns down? No. So with Rebecca, can I take back those words that I said? No, because why? How many people know about that already? Like, everybody heard me say that. Yeah, and if they only tell, like, 5 people each, 1,000 people just found out those words that I shouldn't have said. So it spread out of control just like that fire. And I can't fix it. I can't make it better. I can tell Rebecca I'm sorry, but can I make everyone forget the words that I said? No. The damage has already been done. So the Bible says, be careful with your words. Be careful with your mouth, because our words are like a fire. And our words can be really good. They can lift people up and encourage. Like, I should have said very nice. What could have I said nice about Becca? What nice things should I have said? Yeah, she dresses nice. She's pretty. She gets good grades. I could have said all sorts of nice things. But instead, I said something that did damage. So we have to be very, very careful with our words. We can use our words to praise God and encourage people, but our words can also hurt. And so we have to be very, very careful with our words. Because once our words are out there, we can't get them back and we can't fix it. We can't make things the way they used to be. So let's be very, very careful with the things we say, okay? Why don't you pray with me? Let's use our words to talk to the Lord. Dear gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you. You give us millions of words to use. And so, Lord, help us to use those words to encourage one another, to praise you, to worship you. And, Lord, keep the words from our mouth that dishonor you and that dishonor one another. Help keep lies and gossip and discouragement away from our lips. Lord, forgive us for the times where we have started those fires with our words. So, Lord, we thank you that you give us words to praise you. But, Lord, we also ask that you guard our mouths, guard our words, Lord, so that we can lift one another up as brothers and sisters in Christ and never hurt one another with our words. In your name we pray. Amen.
All right, Andrew's over on the side. You guys can get a piece of candy from him.
Let us pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, Lord, you do give us the words to praise you, words to speak to you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for that ability to communicate with you, communicate with one another. Lord, we do thank you for the opportunity to worship and praise you. And we ask now that you just give us hearts that are focused upon you. Lord, we thank you for the good gifts of our offerings, gifts that come from you. Everything is yours, Lord Jesus, and we acknowledge that here this morning. Lord, we do pray for our church, that you continue to help us to be a light in the darkness. Lord, that you just allow your Holy Spirit to dwell here as we worship together. Lord, that we would feel your Holy Spirit move as we worship and praise you. Heavenly Father, this morning we pray specifically for those in our church that need healing. We continue to pray for Don and Jackie, Kevin, and Earl, Armin and Shar, Noreen, Matthew, Candy, Eldon, and Lisa. Lord, we lift up Thomas, Richard, and Phyllis, Bridget, Ryan, Graydon, Kara, Dean, and Clara. Heavenly Father, we pray specifically over Jennifer and Nora, Linda Tearks, Tiffany, and Angie. Lord, you know each person. You know the number of hairs on their head, your word says. You know what's going on inside their bodies right now. And if it be your will, Lord, we pray for a powerful healing in the name of Jesus, that his name would bring a miraculous healing to those that we list and those that we know in our own lives and name in our hearts. Heavenly Father, we know that you can do all things, and we cling to the promise that you are the great physician. We take a moment now to just remember those in our own lives, Lord, that need your healing hand. Heavenly Father, we do pray in thanksgiving for the marriage of Orion and Brandy Schody. Lord, we pray blessings upon their new life together. Heavenly Father, we just ask that you be in the midst of their marriage, that you would be that third cord that cannot be broken, as your word says. Lord, we thank you for our Sunday school, our teachers, our students, the parents that bring them each week. Lord, that your word is proclaimed here each week, and we thank you for those young people who remember your word and keep it in their hearts. Heavenly Father, this morning we remember our servicemen and women, specifically those from our church and our community. We ask that you guard and protect them, Lord. Give them vision for their future. Heavenly Father, we pray for their families as well. Give them a strength and comfort that comes from you. Lord, we ask a special blessing upon those that give their lives to protect our country. Heavenly Father, we pray for the persecuted church. This morning, we pray specifically for the believers in Colombia and South America. Lord, that you would just allow your word to spread throughout the world. Lord, we pray for our local churches. This morning, we pray specifically for Newark Lutheran and Pastor John Benson. Give that congregation a blessing this morning. Lord, we pray for our local ministries, Jesus is the Way and Rantoul, that you would be with that board, be with the leaders over there as they decide the direction of that ministry, be with the men that are committed to living at Jesus is the Way. Lord, you are the God of new beginnings, and we pray that you make them a new creation in Christ. Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise you. The creator of the universe hears our prayers, and not only hears them, but answers according to his good and perfect will. So Lord, as we pray these petitions, we do submit to your will, knowing that you are good and sovereign. Lord, we ask for your will to be done in our lives and in the lives of those that we pray for. Heavenly Father, this morning we do pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I would ask that you please stand for the singing of our next hymn.
Our sermon title is Stumbling, Bumbling, and Mumbling, and that's a little bit of what's going on this morning. So let's focus our attention on Jesus and show him how he gives us the song to sing.
Okay. be with you. Pray with me, please. Father God, you are a God who uses stumbling, bumbling, and mumbling. You are a God who gives power and life to jars of clay, to broken vessels, to all of us who may fail in many points, stumble in many ways, but God, you give more grace. You give mercy to us. And so, God, we cling to your mercy this morning. God, as we hear from the scriptures and as we've prayed and as we've heard the word of God and sang to you, God, I pray that the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart, all of it, will be pleasing in your sight. God, be with us. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're continuing our sermon series through James, so I'd invite you, if you have your Bible, you can go ahead and open to James chapter 3 is where we're going to be today. And today what we're going to be talking about is bridling our tongue. Anyone familiar with this contraption here? Anyone know what this is? This here is a bit and a bridle. We're going to get more on that here because we're going to be talking about bridling our tongue, controlling our tongue, and allowing the Lord to guide the words that we say. But first, I'd love to tell you two embarrassing stories, all right? And by I love to tell you two embarrassing stories, I do not like to tell you these stories, but they're very helpful, and they help us just kind of see how it's difficult, and also it's very important to control the words that we say. That what we come out of our mouth, that what comes out of our mouth is very important. I told these two stories to my wife. Both of these happened when I was in eighth grade. And I told these two stories to my wife, and she said, well, you were kind of your worst self when you were in eighth grade. So here comes. First story, when I took one class at Armstrong High School, okay, so Armstrong alum for one class, my freshman year, my eighth grade year, I went to freshman algebra over at Armstrong. Carl Park would take me from Gifford Grade School to Armstrong for one class and then cart me back over. And so I was in that class, and Miss Bird was the teacher. I think she teaches at the grade school now. And so Miss Bird was the teacher of that class. And there was one time we were kind of like doing, it was kind of a study hall type thing. We were doing homework in class. And I just talked in class all the time, constantly. It was a problem. Like people, like teachers always had to like put me far away from everyone else or else I talked to people. So I was talking to one of my classmates, and Ms. Bird was hearing this, and she was like, Scott, what are you doing? To which I replied, I don't know. What are you doing? Just a reasonable thing to say, right, to your teacher. And she said, all right, well, you can go see the principal. And so I left class, but I didn't go to school there, so I just left the building. And you might be thinking, man, that boy needs Jesus. And amen, yes, I do. I very much do. And so that was one thing. It just came out of me, right? It just came out. You know, I wasn't really thinking about what I was saying. The second incident happened at Rantoul High School. I was in eighth grade, but we'd go over there in eighth grade as school was getting out to get ready for football. We would do workouts. And so the head coach of Rantoul football was showing us eighth graders around the weight room. It's in the basement there at the high school. And he's showing us around, and he said, he was trying to be encouraging. He said, now, don't feel like you have to be just big and strong, like, all in one day, right? Working out takes time. You know, how many days did it take God to create the heavens and the earth? And, you know, good Christian answer, I said, 7. And he said, well, actually, it was 6, you know. They made it in 6, and he rested on the 7th day. So I looked this man in the eye, this head football coach, and I said, don't contradict me. I don't know. I have no words for why I did any of these things. And if looks could kill, there'd be a little memorial plaque for me there in the high school weight room. Like, I was about to die. And so those stories just kind of illustrate two things, really. One, that sometimes we don't have the filter that we should. Sometimes, especially, you know, as kids, but even as adults, right? I'm sure, you know, these stories are very uncomfortable for me to tell. I think about it and my heart just drops, like, oh, that was so foolish. And I'm sure all of you in here can probably relate to that foolishness just a little bit. You could probably tell me some stories that if you told them to me as you recall it, as you say it, it's like, oh, that makes me uncomfortable just thinking about things that I said. And so we see that this is a thing in our lives, a reality of us, that controlling the tongue is harder than it should be, right? We know these things that we are going to say, they're not right, but we say it anyway, right? We know that it's going to cause pain. We know that it's going to cause damage. We know that it's going to make us feel foolish, and it's just not going to be good, but we say it anyway. It's almost as if we can't control what we say sometimes. Am I it here? Am I the only one? Anyone else feel that way just a little bit sometimes? All right. You know, it's just the things that we say aren't always good, aren't always helpful, aren't always thought through, and sometimes it gets us in trouble. Young adult Sunday school, there we go, college age Sunday school, last week, Ben Gould was talking about this, and he said, you know, it's kind of the hardest thing to control what you say, because it's just, you're thinking about it in your head, and it's on your heart, and it's just like, that's what comes out of you, right? And Jesus said something very similar. Michelle read it earlier. It says, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. It's just in us. It's just there. And sometimes it comes out, and we're like, oh no, that shouldn't have came out. Like Gary said in the children's sermon, we can't take it back. It's difficult, and it's just something that we find very hard. It's not a value in our culture here in America. It's not a value in our culture to watch our words. Matter of fact, it's kind of the opposite. Say what's on your mind. Say what's on your heart. Put it out there. Let it be discussed. Let it be worked through. And if you see if you're on social media right now, a lot of what's going on is talking about the Roe versus Wade thing, whether that's getting overturned or not. And you have people from both sides saying these just like inflammatory things. That's not a value in our culture right now just to watch what we say. Watch what we type. Watch what we put out there. It's out there, and it stays out there, and it hurts, and it damages things. It's not something we find beautiful in our culture, but when it happens, we see that it's ugly, right? We see the pain and destruction that can come, or just the pure foolishness that can come when we don't watch what we say. We use our words for about everything in life. And as followers of Christ, our words had better be ones that are beautiful, that are upbuilding, that are helpful and loving and kind. That's not always the way it is. A few weeks ago, Gary talked about how we should be slow to speak. There's a lot of wisdom in that, how we should be slow to speak. And then last week in James chapter 2, we talked about how our words, you know, our words are good, but our actions speak more. But that doesn't take away from the value of our words. Our words are also very important. In James chapter 3, where we're going to be looking today, there's kind of a shift. If you look in verse 2 with me, James chapter 3, verse 2, there's kind of a shift. James in the first two chapters, he's kind of saying, you need to do this, you need to do that. But then he gets very empathetic. He gets very like, all right, we're kind of in this together. If you look in verse 2 of James chapter 3, he says, for we all stumble in many ways. Notice that. He didn't say you all stumble in many ways. He says we all stumble in many ways. Even James, who's writing this letter, he says, look, this is all of us. We all stumble in many ways, especially in the words that we say, especially in what comes out of our mouth. And he goes on and says, if anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to bridle his whole body. Like, think about that. He says, if you have the love and the discipline to watch what you say, if you don't stumble, if you don't mess up in the words that you say, you're perfect. You have that much discipline. You have that much love. You have that much, what would you call it? Working of God in your life, that you're perfect. But he also says that's kind of hypothetical. That's kind of not where we're at right now. All of us in this room, we stumble in many ways. All of us in this room need desperately God's mercy. We confessed it in our confession of sin. We stumble. We don't build up with our words. And sometimes we walk in foolishness. James goes on and he says that you know, if a person able to bridle his tongue, he's a perfect man. And so here I have a bit and a bridle. I went to Michael Remley at Hooves of Hope, and he had to explain this thing to me because I was like, what do you do? What is this? So this part here, this part is the bit, okay? And this part, where does the bit go? In the horse's mouth, like this. No, not really. That's gross. But the bit goes in the mouth, and so you put the bit in here, and then you have these reins, and you can kind of like, you know, move the horse's head in his mouth, and you kind of guide the horse where you want it to go, right? And James is saying it's so important for us as Christians to put a bit in our mouths, to bridle our tongues, to not just let it, woo, go free, but to control it, to watch our mouths, to be careful with what we say, because our words can do damage. Our words need to be not just willy-nilly, but they need to be directed towards something. They need to be directed towards making peace, not tearing down, not foolishness. If you're taking notes, the first line in your notes, the main point today, the main point is make peace with your tongue, with peace in your heart. Make peace with your tongue, with peace in your heart. Our job as Christians is to not just say whatever, but our job is to use our tongues for blessing, for building up, for making peace. You know it when you see it. If you're making peace with someone, if your words are used to give life and not bring death, that's what Christians are called to do. And that comes from the heart. It's not just watching our mouth. It's not just, you know, being careful with what we say, because what we say really does come from down deep. And so if we're going to have peace with our mouth, if we're going to be peaceful with our neighbor, our friends, coworkers, family, and friends, we've got to have peace in our heart. And so that's what we're going to be talking about today, letting our tongues be guided by the Lord to peace, peace with our heart. If we keep looking in James chapter 3, he gives some warnings and some pictures about the tongue, and they're pretty good illustrations, so I want to read that for us. Let's look in verses 3 through 8 together. James says, "But if we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we guide their whole bodies as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are guided by a very very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great things. How great a forest is set ablaze by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire, a world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird and reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind, but no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison." James gives us warning. Like Gary brought up, the tongue is like a fire, and fire spreads. That's why, you know, out west they have these forest fires and they go across the whole states and they have to get helicopters and all sorts of fire teams out to stop them, because the tongue is destructive. If you're taking notes, the next point in your notes is that we damage people with our words. Our words burn. Our words hurt. Our words can destroy. A lot of times our words don't bring peace, but instead it's more like our tongues are like wrecking balls reared back, ready to come and bust down the building. Like that's what's in us. That's what comes out of us. These words that come out not thought through, foolish, and coming from maybe bitterness or hatred or hurt or pain, those things come out of us and they cause destruction. In Romans chapter 3, Michelle read that passage for us. I want to dial in. I want to look back at it. Romans chapter 3, I want to look at verses 13 through 17. You can turn there if you'd like. Romans 3, verses 13 through 17. If I can turn these pages here. Here we go. Romans 3, 13 through 17. Paul is speaking about mankind. Paul is speaking about how we use our tongues. And in verse 13, he says, "Their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood, and their paths are ruin and misery. And the way of peace they have not known. And so, James talks here about the damage people do with words. In Paul, in that passage, he talks about how the tongue can bring ruin and misery. Some of you may have experienced this in your life. The words that someone said to you hurt, and you carry it with you to this day. And probably all of us at some point have been on the opposite end of that. Our words have been that venom. Our words have been that fire. Our words have been that wrecking ball, that hurt that we have caused others that they may carry with them to this day. Our words are so dangerous. Proverbs says that life and death are in the power of the tongue. We have the power with our words to help build people up, but we also have the power to tear people down. It's dangerous. You can do major destruction with the words that you say. And it's more than just putting our foot in our mouth. It's more than just saying silly things. This could be verbal abuse. There's probably a lot of people we know that would say, I would still have my marriage. I would still have a relationship with my family. I would still have my job. I would still see my children. I would still be a part of a church I was a part of if I watched what I said. Words are powerful. Words are damaging. You, in all likelihood, you have hurt someone with your words. I've done it too. There was a time when I was a kid, I was pretty young, but I would go to my dad's on the weekends, and there was a friend of mine. He was kind of an older kid than me, but we hung out, and he would ride his bike around, and I would kind of walk with him because I was pretty young. And we would just hang out and talk. And then one day, a bunch of these other kids from the neighborhood, I don't even know who they were, but a bunch of these other kids in the neighborhood started making fun of my friend, we'll call him Sean. They started making fun of this guy. And they started like calling him names and just being really mean. And I don't know why, but for whatever reason, I joined the side against my friend. I would join the mob that was making fun of Sean. And so I started saying awful things to him. And then I started throwing stuff at him. And then he got on his bike, of course, and he was crying, and he rode off. And I realized that in that moment, I was like, oh my, I just damaged him. I just hurt him. That's a scar. And we, you know, we met up back together, but our relationship was never the same after that. And you may have some similar stories. And you see it. You see it all the time, how destructive our words can be. We got to have a grip on it. We gotta watch what we say. We gotta have words that make for peace and not for destruction. There's too much at stake. There's people's lives. We gotta be so careful. We can't use our words for cursing or unrighteousness. James talks about it staining our whole body. He talks about the tongue being a restless evil, just like waiting to hurt people. Like, have you ever done that? Like, someone's talking and you're just like waiting for them to get done talking so you can like blast them. It's a poison. It's a restless evil. It's a fire. You have so much destructive power. We hurt and damage people with our words. Then there's more bad news. Next point in your notes, we can't fix it. We can't fix, in our own strength, we can't fix the words that we say. Again, it just feels like sometimes we have no filter. It sometimes feels like things just come out of us. We hurt people and we're like, oh no, why did I say that? And we can't fix it. My nephew, Bronson, he's turning 5 here soon. And we were over at his grandma's house, my mother-in-law. And one time he was saying something and my grandma or his grandma said, watch your mouth. And he kind of looked down like this. He's kind of looking, you know, towards this, and he, like, puckered his lips out. And he said, I can't. I can't watch my mouth. He's a very literal fella. And so, like, you know, what Bronson had was, like, pure wisdom there. That's so true for all of us. We can't just watch our mouth. We can't just, all right, I'm going to just do it. I'm going to just say nice things all the time. Like, we can't do that. We can't watch
our mouths. We don't have the power in our own strength to do that. In verse 8, James says the same thing. Look with me in verse 8. We read it before. We'll read it again. It says, but no human being can tame the tongue. No human being can do it. None of us in this room can just fix it. Our tongue is just like, we try to do it. We try to be right, and it just gets away from us. Like, no human being can tame the tongue. Why? Why not? You know, what if we just said, well, I just won't say much. You know, I'll just try not to talk at all. But then it's kind of like just building up in us. You know, has anyone ever done the Diet Coke and Mentos thing where you put Mentos and Diet Coke? I have some Diet Coke here to illustrate. Not really. That would be a mess. our cleaning staff is like, praise the Lord. All right. But what it does is like it just bubbles in there. And you know, you put Mentos in the Diet Coke and it just stirs up, pow, and it comes out. And that's how it is with our words sometimes. If we just bottle it up, if we just store it in our heart and we just try not to say anything, we just try to do better, we just try to watch our mouths, it stirs up, pow, and it comes out and it's really destructive. Like, we can't just fix it. We can't just, all right, do better. I'm going to watch what I say. That we don't have that ability in us. And even if we did, even if we could just not say bad things, there's also a time to speak. Ecclesiastes 3:7 says there is a time to keep silence. It's good, be slow to speak, but there's also a time to speak. Proverbs 31:9 says, open your mouth, judge righteously, defend the rights of the poor and needy. So not only do we say things that hurt people, we don't say things that help people. We're in a bad state. We're in a bad shape. If we look in James 3, look down with me at verse 14. He gets to the heart of the problem here. He says, but if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition, where? In your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. Bitter jealousy, selfish ambition. We have all these things, all these emotions, all these hurts, all these sins, sinful things that we carry around in our hearts, and it just comes out at people like arrows. And we can't just fix it. We can't just put the bow down. We need help. We need our Lord and our Father to help us because we're weak. We don't want to be hypocrites. We don't want to talk out of both sides of our mouth. James says, look with me in verses 9 and 10. He says, with the tongue we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse the people who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers, these things ought not to be so. We talk out of both sides of our mouths sometimes. We come here to church and we praise the Lord. We clap, we sing, we pray, we praise, we give thanks. And then throughout the week, we might curse people made in the likeness of God. It's dangerous stuff we got going here. Like, James makes a big deal about this because it is a big deal. We need to be very careful. And so, all right, let's review. Our words damage people. We can't fix it. Any ideas? What do we do? Any helpful tips out there? Well, James has that for us. But first, I want us to look at the one who did not stumble. I want us to look at the one who did tame his tongue and who did say only upbuilding and kind and gracious words. I want us to look at Jesus. Jesus only ever said wise speech. In Luke 4:22, you can look that up later, but Jesus was speaking to his hometown in Nazareth, and it said they marveled at him for his gracious words. Jesus is said to have words of eternal life. Jesus has said, I am the truth, and whoever hears the truth listens to my voice. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus is God's Word, God's kind and loving and gracious Word to us. And God's Word comes and saves us from our words. God's Word comes and delivers us. When we speak evil, Jesus comes in with the good. When we damage people, Jesus comes in with healing of the broken heart. Jesus never stumbled in any way. Jesus was the perfect man. He endured verbal abuse. He was denied by words, but he never opened his, he opened not his mouth, even when he was being put to death. He endured evil words, and he rescues us from those evil words. He puts out the fire of our tongue. And so in your notes, the last point, we can't fix it is right before this, but the last point is God can fix it. Jesus Christ came into the world to deliver us from our evil words. And he gives us the strength when we trust in him, when we believe in him, when we depend on him, when we give Jesus the bridle of our tongue and say, Jesus, help me. Jesus, take this. Jesus, you were perfect and I am not. I give this over to you. He gives us the power. He gives us the strength. He guides our mouth. He guides our tongue. He guides our words in truth. He helps us. We cannot do it in our strength, but Jesus can. We can't fix it, but God can. Our job is to trust in him, to look in him, to receive his healing and forgiveness for the words that we've spoken or the words that have been spoken to you. Many of us in here, again, are carrying around those words that people have said to us. Jesus offers you healing. He wants to mend your broken heart. He wants to bind you up. He wants to give you the strength to love and forgive and continue to serve him. And those of us in here that have hurt people with our words, Jesus gives you the forgiveness. He says, come to me. Come to me. Peter denied him 3 times and Jesus restored him. Jesus has gracious words to us. He says, come. Come and be forgiven. Come and put that behind you. I forgive you and I want to heal that. We trust in Jesus. And even though in ourselves we think it's uncomfortable, we think it's foolish, we think of things we said as kids or adults and it's bad, Jesus says, I covered it all. I died for it all. I rose for it all. Come to me and be healed and don't walk in that stuff anymore. Don't walk in that foolishness anymore. Let me help you. That's what Jesus offers to us. And that's important. It's important to know that you have forgiveness of God, and only then can you really go and love others. Only then can you really make peace with words you say, because if you have God's forgiveness, that's the peace in your heart. If you have God's healing from wrongs that other people have done to you, that puts peace in your heart. That gets rid of that bitterness and jealousy and selfish ambition, and it gives you peace. And when that peace is in your heart, then you can make peace with your tongue. You can make peace with your words. Love God and love people in peace. James says something similar. Let's look in verse 17 of James 3. He says, but the wisdom from above. So again, from God. God is helping us. He's giving us wisdom from above. It's first pure, then peaceable, then gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Isn't that so different than what we've heard the rest of the day? That our words are fire, that our words are set on fire by hell. No, what God wants to give you is help from above, help that you can't do yourself, to give you pure, peaceable, gentle, open to reason, impartial and sincere, full of mercy kind of words. That's what God wants for us. That's what followers of Christ get to speak. Again, we get to hand this bridle over to the Lord and say, Lord, I need you. Help me. Help me. Guide me by your Holy Spirit so that I have that peace in my heart so that it comes out of my mouth. I want to give you one challenge this week. I want to give you one challenge. I want you to think of one person that you have the hardest time saying nice, peaceful words to. Think of one person. You have a hard time. They just kind of get under your skin. They bother you, or they might have hurt you in the past. One person. And as you see them this week, or as you see them in the upcoming days, speak peace to them. Let God help you speak peace to them. Be kind to them. Don't bring up stuff. Don't let bitterness come out of your mouth, but speak peace to them. Let the Lord help you. And if you can do that with the person you have the hardest time with, you're going to see the Lord's faithfulness in that, and that's going to help you speak peace to everyone. That's going to help you speak peace in all your relationships. We want to make sure that we're not tearing down, but we're building up. We want to make sure that we're speaking peace and not destruction. As I was thinking about this, I kind of thought of wild horses. Anyone ever seen wild horses just running around? You know, they're beautiful, right? It's cool. They run around, you know, they're big groups in the open plains in the West. But you know what wild horses are? Useless. I mean, really, like, they're fun to look at, but other than that, what else you got, right? You can't ride them. You can't pet them. You can't bring your kids around them. You can't use them for work or anything like that. They're just out there running around. They're useless. Why? Because you can't bridle them. And I would say to us that if we as Christians, if we in this room, followers of Christ, if we are not willing to bridle our tongues, if we're not willing to give those reins over to God and let Him guide us by His Holy Spirit, we're useless. We're wild horses running around. We're not going to be used for the kingdom of God. We're useless. Let me say it another way. If anyone thinks he's religious and does not bridle his tongue but deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. That's James 1:26. This is way too important just to breeze by. You have a calling. You have a mission to speak peace. You have a calling and you have a mission to ask the Lord to repent of your sin, to look to Jesus and to ask God for help. Put that peace in my heart. Give me that wisdom from above so that I'm useful for your kingdom. And just imagine, if we were a people who didn't damage people with our words, but we spoke peace instead, and if we were a people who had peace in our hearts and that affected our actions, man, we would be known for that. We'd be known for that as a community. And so, speak peace. Let peace in your tongue come from peace in your heart. Let God change your heart. What a difference that would be. Let's pray together. Father God, we need your help desperately. We can't tame the tongue. We need your help. We give you the bridle of our tongue, Lord God, and we pray that you would guide us. You would steer us towards peace. And you would help us be people who speak peace and not just go off the cuff. Give us your filter, Lord God. Let us be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. Give us peace in our hearts, Lord, through Jesus Christ. We need it. Let us be known for that. We bless you, Lord, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together and let's sing our closing hymn, Make Me a Blessing. our prayer that God would make us a blessing. And I want you to receive this blessing from Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Paul says, "Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another. And if one has a complaint against each other, another, forgive each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, and thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him." Be a blessing. Use your words. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, and let the peace of Christ come out of your mouth this week. Amen? Amen. Be blessed. Go in peace and serve the Lord. It's fellowship time. Amen.